Now, dear ones, maybe we could just tonight talk a little more about the God's life and the body. Maybe before I begin, it would be good just to deal with that question, which is, can we really expect healing of residual pains of bodily injuries sustained years ago? And presumably that's the kind of injury you would get in a car accident. And do you see that we cannot divide diseases up into structural diseases, which would be that kind of thing, and infectious diseases, invasive diseases, and spiritual and emotional diseases, and then say that God can only heal one category. God can heal any kind of weakness or sickness. And we'll see that in some of the promises that he gives us in his word, that God will heal any kind of weakness or sickness, anything that really is hindering us from being what he wants us to be in his kingdom's work. And so, yeah, I mean, God will heal those things as well. And God will not only heal infectious or invasive diseases, but will heal sicknesses or weaknesses that come from that kind of thing. One of the things that we have to be very sure of is really to find out from him whether we were in some way at fault in that situation. I remember a girl who had a car accident, and really, in some sense, it was an attitude of sin or carelessness that had caused the accident. Now, it would be important there, as with every other sickness, to say, Father, what are you trying to show me in this, you see? And then to confess it and to get it right. But then to trust God for the healing and the wholeness of the sickness. And I have known brothers and sisters who have been healed, yes, of this kind of thing. So maybe you can push me further on it, you know, as we come to the end and to the question time. Dear ones, what we've been saying is really contained in 1 Corinthians 6 and 19. What we've been sharing the past few Sundays on sickness. 1 Corinthians 6 and verse 19, and it's page 994. 1 Corinthians 6 and 19. Do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit within you, which you have from God? Now, why didn't God say, do you not know that your spirit is a temple of the Holy Spirit? Why did he say, do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit? And the answer is because he reckons that his Holy Spirit, who dwells within our spirits, will move out and discipline our souls and bring peace to our minds and balance to our emotions and liberty to our wills, and then we'll move out into our bodies and bring complete redemption and wholeness to our bodies. And that's what we've been saying, that God's Spirit who dwells within us brings complete wholeness to every part of us and brings wholeness to our bodies. And we used, you remember, the example of Jesus, who at the Transfiguration found that this resurrection life was bursting through his physical body and not only filled him to completeness so that he was utterly healthy, but actually broke through so that he seemed to be shining and transfigured on that mountaintop. And then, of course, on the resurrection day, really his spiritual body broke through completely and just transformed his physical body. And so that's what we've been saying, that God's Holy Spirit will bring life to our own bodies, not only to our minds or to our spirits or to our emotions, but actually to our bodies. And you get that, you know, in Romans 8 and verse 11. And it's really the parts of the Bible that are important in what we share. Romans 8 and verse 11. It's page 983, Romans 8 and 11. If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies also through his Spirit which dwells in you. And the important word is mortal, you see. It doesn't say corruptible body, as when, you remember, Paul is talking about the resurrection, when this corruptible body will be put on incorruptibility. But it says our mortal body, that is our present body, our physical body. If God's Spirit dwells in you, that Spirit will give life to your physical body. It will actually fill your physical body with health and wholeness. And that's God's promise, you see. Never does God look upon the body as an old physical prison cell that we have to escape from or that we have to put up with. But he looks upon our body always as something that is sharing the wholeness of the Holy Spirit. Now, you find that in 1 Timothy 6 and verse 12. 1 Timothy 6 and verse 12. 1 Timothy 6. And it's about page 1036. 1 Timothy 6 and 12. Fight the good fight of the faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called when you made the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. Now, do you see the words? Take hold of the eternal life. And there are many of us who dwell in weakness and sickness because we don't take hold of the eternal life which is within us and realize that that is to be taken by us for physical wholeness and health. And God says, you see, take hold of it. Don't just let it dwell within and say, oh yeah, the Holy Spirit takes care of the spiritual side of my life. He takes care of the Christian side, the witnessing side, the prayer side. But this body I have to struggle along with through drugs and through medicine as well as I can. God's word is always, no, take hold of the life that is inside you. And of course, we need to do that, you know. There is a Holy Spirit within you that is complete wholeness. The Hebrew word for holiness means health. It means health. And the Holy Spirit within you will bring health to your own body. Now you can see that there are really two laws at work in your body. There's sort of the law of consumption. There's the consuming of energy that goes on inside you continually. Just an eating up and a burning up of energy. In walking along, in running, in speaking, in exercising yourself, in thinking, in feeling. There's just a consumption of energy. And then there is a replenishment, a law of replenishment, whereby life comes into you through rest and through food and through sleep. And those two really should be balanced all the time inside your body for perfect health. Now, in a Christian's life, there is an extra consumption taking place over that of a non-Christian. Now, you can see that if you look at it in Galatians 4 and 19. Galatians 4 and 19, where Paul mentions that in his own life. Galatians 4 and 19. It's page 1014, Galatians 4 and 19. My little children, with whom I am again in travail until Christ be formed in you. And Paul says, with whom I am again in travail. Now that's just one of the consumption exercises or drains on energy that a Christian has that a non-Christian has not. There is a travailing and a laboring in prayer that non-Christians know nothing about. There is a fighting against Satan that non-Christians know nothing about. There is a resisting Satan that non-Christians don't have to worry about too much. In other words, there are a lot of consuming factors in a Christian's life that use up energy that a non-Christian does not have to face. Now, that's why many Christians have no trouble with their health until they begin to really live for Jesus. Many of us had no trouble with weakness or weariness of body until we began really to be a priest unto Jesus. Many of us, until we were filled with the Holy Spirit, never engaged in this kind of warfare, and so we never had this kind of strain upon our bodies. Now, do you see, this is why it's vital for those who are Christians to not only depend on food and rest and sleep to replenish their own energies, but to depend on Jesus himself. Brothers and sisters, you cannot live the strenuous life of a Christian in your body without receiving the life of Jesus for your body. And that is why, you know, there's a part in the Bible that says, the Lord is for the body. And the Lord Jesus is for your body. And you really need to receive his life for your body. You need really to receive him into your body to fill you with himself. And that's why, you know, Jesus says so often that he is the vine and you are the branches. And it's vital for us to receive the life that runs through the main plant of the vine into the branches. And if you're not living that way, really, you'll go down. There's a part of the Bible, really, that explains it well in Matthew 4 and verse 4. Matthew 4 and verse 4. That Christians need not only food and rest, but something deeper than that. Matthew 4 and verse 4. And it's one of Jesus' replies, you remember, to Satan in the wilderness. But he answered, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. And God's own word, through the Holy Spirit, is life to a Christian. And it's life for your body. And yet you see the other side, that it does say, man shall not live by bread alone. And so we need to take care of our bodies. We need to eat right. And we need to sleep right. And we need to exercise right. But do you see, after you've done all that, you'll crash in a physical or nervous breakdown unless you've learned to eat of Jesus' body itself. Unless you've learned to take him into yourself as health and wholeness and energy, you'll wear out, you know. Old Simpson, you remember, puts it like this. Then the body broke away in every sort of way. I had always worked hard, and from the age of 14, I studied and labored and spared no strength. I took charge of a large congregation at the age of 21. I broke down utterly half a dozen times, and at my last constitution was worn out. Many times I feared I should drop dead in my pulpit. I could not ascend any height without a sense of suffocation because of a broken down heart and exhausted nervous system. I heard of the Lord's healing, but I struggled against it. I was afraid of it. I had been taught in theological seminaries that the age of the supernatural was past, and I could not go back from my early training. My head was in my way. But at last, when I was brought to attend the funeral of my dogmatics, the Lord whispered to me the little secret, Christ in you. And from that hour, I received him for my body as I had done for my soul. I was made so strong and well that work has been a perfect delight. For years I have spent my summer holiday in the hot city of New York, preaching and working among the masses, as I never did before. Besides the work of our home and college and an immense mass of library work and much besides. But the Lord did not merely remove my sufferings. It was more than simple healing. He so gave me himself that I lost the painful consciousness of physical organs. That is the best of the health he gives. I thank the Lord that he keeps me from all morbid physical consciousness and a body that is the object of anxious care, and gives a simple life that is a delight and a service for the Master, that is a rest and joy. And really it's true, you know. It really is true. I had some weaknesses in my own body that I cosseted and looked after and took care of and tried to treat with exercise and with the right rest. And Jesus came in and worked a miracle. And as long as I trust him, and as long as I eat his flesh and drink his blood into myself, so long the health stays. And loved ones, it is a miracle. And it is God's will, you know. Not only that he will heal our sicknesses, but that he will keep us well and keep us healthy. And that happens so long as we take the Lord God himself for our bodies. The Lord is for the body. The Lord is not just for the spirit. He is not just for the soul. The Lord Jesus is for your body. You can actually receive Jesus for your bodily health and wholeness. You know, this goes right through the Old Testament. Just as you look through it, you find all the time that God preserved his own servants and his saints in health and wholeness. And you find that even in the case of Paul, as you'll see a little later, you know, even where the sickness still remained as far as the outward phenomena was concerned, yet there was health and wholeness that enabled these men to do God's work without any holding back. Now, you find that promise, you know, God's own will in Deuteronomy 33 and 25. Deuteronomy 33 and 25. And you do need a promise, a clear promise in His Word, in order to go before Him in this regard. Deuteronomy 33 and 25. Your bars shall be iron and bronze, and as your days, so shall your strength be. And as your days, so shall your strength be. That means, as long as you're alive, your strength will be there available to you. And so really, it's up to us to get up each morning, you see, whatever the night before has been like. However restless we have been in sleep, it is good to get up each morning and say, Father, you've said, as my days are, so shall my strength be. Now, this is another day you've given me. Now, I trust you to make that promise real. And I take your life now. I take your life now into me for this day. And brothers and sisters, it means a disregarding of the feelings in the body, you see, or the feelings and the emotions. It means a walk by faith, not by sight. But as you receive that, so God gives you strength. And as your days are, so will your strength be. In other words, it is God's will for His children to be robust and healthy as long as they're alive. And really, in a way, to die well, you see. To die well. And even if we die with Paul, like Paul with a thorn in the flesh, to die well. To die indifferent to whatever physical ailment there seems to be, and in no way held back to that, by that physical ailment. Now, that's what you find right through Scripture, you know. Look at Abraham in Romans 4 and 9. You remember it refers to him. Romans 4 and verse 9. And 19, I'm sorry. Romans 4 and 19. He did not weaken in faith when he considered his own body, which was as good as dead, because he was about 100 years old, or when he considered the barrenness of Sarah's womb. No distrust made him waver concerning the promise of God, but he grew strong in his faith as he gave glory to God, fully convinced that God was able to do what he had promised. And Abraham was nearly 100 years of age, and he did not weaken in faith when he considered his own body, which was as good as dead. Now, the body still remained as good as dead. Do you see that? The body didn't suddenly blossom with a young man's body. The body was still as good as dead. But God gave Abraham the kind of strength and life that enabled him to have a son. And gave Sarah's body the same kind of life that enabled her to bear a son. See, the body remained as good as dead. The body remained old. It's just that the life of Jesus is different from physical life. Do you see that? See, you could have all the signs of cancer with Jesus' life and still continue a full ministry. I knew a man, Brian Hessian, a different Brian Hessian from the Calvary Road, another man in England, a minister, who was dying of cancer. He never was healed of cancer. At least, the world would have said he never was healed. He had countless operations after operations, and everybody would say, you see, oh, he wasn't believing. The man had hardly anything inside him left. They had cut away organs upon organs, and he continued a full ministry right to the moment he went into the Father's arms. And he actually traveled around the country. I met him in Ireland. He traveled round the country and he traveled into Europe. And he had, really, they were cutting away all the time, more operations upon operations. But the life of Jesus is separate from the phenomena in the physical body, you see. It's separate from those symptoms. So that a man can walk with a body that the world would say cannot uphold any kind of ministry. And that man can walk in strength. So it's not the symptoms. Now again, I remind you that it's not just that God does that. He does that with some people. With most people, he makes them whole and well. But even when he lets the symptoms continue, he gives a life that is different from physical life, and that manages to enable you to continue a full ministry and a full work. Now you see it again with Moses, Deuteronomy 34 and 7. Deuteronomy 34 and 7. It's page 185. Deuteronomy 34 and 7. Moses was 120 years old when he died. His eye was not dim, nor his natural force abated. Now that's at 120. Now that's God's will. God can keep us, as long as it's his will for us to continue in this world, he can keep us well. He can keep us like that. His eye was not dim, nor his natural force abated. And it's the same, you know, you read it with Joshua. If you look at Joshua 14 and 9 through 11. Joshua 14, 9 through 11. I think maybe it's Caleb, the other scout, that was sent into the promised land. Joshua 14 and 9 through 11. And Moses swore on that day, saying, surely the land on which your foot has trodden shall be an inheritance for you and your children forever, because you have wholly followed the Lord my God. And now, behold, the Lord has kept me alive, as he said, these 45 years, since the time that the Lord spoke this word to Moses, while Israel walked in the wilderness. And now, lo, I am this day 85 years old. I am still as strong to this day as I was in the day that Moses sent me. My strength now is as my strength was then, for war and for going and coming. And that is God's word to us. If God wants you to live to 85, he will give you the health and the strength to live until that time. As your days are, so will your strength be. And so it goes on. You know, I could give you lots of references about David and about Joshua himself, about Job, about Elihu. Again and again, saints of God that found that God did give them strength and that the Lord was for the body. And you know, if that was in those days, then how much more now in the days of the Holy Spirit, you know, when grace is flowing like a river and it is plentiful for all of us. Now, do you see, the one condition is that it is for God's work. You find that, you know, that it is for God's work. You remember that promise about the diseases that God had put upon the Egyptians. He said, none of those diseases will I put upon you if you abide in my statutes. Now, brothers and sisters, it does mean that you have to live a life that is only for Jesus. And I tell you this, as soon as your eyes turn in on yourselves and you begin to live for yourself and for your own pleasure, really, the strength of God is no longer available. And you'll find that, you know. And I've found it in my own life. When you're going out after God's work and God's will, it doesn't matter what the difficulties are. Really, he gives more healing and strength. When you're engaged in his work, there is no shortage of supply. Really. My wife and I joke about it a little. Because if I'm going off to Pittsburgh, Jim, or down to Puerto Rico, or somewhere for a week's meetings, and I'm just feeling tired and wearied, we both know that I'll come back blasting away like mad when I come back from the place. Because it seems that when you're engaged in his work or giving out life, you know, giving out the life that Jesus has given you, it seems that that life flowing through you is like good, clear blood through your arteries. It makes them whole and well. And you see, it is tied to the work of his kingdom, don't you? It cannot be otherwise, you know. You find that in Romans 12, if you look at it. It's the one condition, you remember, that we mentioned at the very beginning of the series on health and on sickness. Romans 12 and verse 1. It's an essential condition if God is going to give you this healing life. I appeal to you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. In other words, you do need to present your bodies as a living sacrifice. You see, for many of us, it ties up with what I was sharing at the beginning about marriage. It means giving your whole body over to the Father. You do with it what you want, Father. Use it or don't use it. Whatever you want to do with it, I give it to you. But it does require us to make that full sacrifice. You need to offer the body to God. If you keep it for yourself, you'll grow weary and weak, really. And it is so every time. And that's why I'm anxious for you to keep going out for Jesus, you see. That's why I'm anxious for us to get out into the world, to the 2.5 billion who do not know Jesus. Loved ones, you'll be a bunch of weak, sick people unless you live for the world for whom Jesus has died. Really. And you'll be all the time wrought up in hospitalization. You'll be all the time wrought up with looking after yourself unless you really go out and live for the world that Jesus has died for. And then if you live for that, really, he will take care. You know, he will hold you up. So he gives you the strength while you're living for him. Turn in on yourself and you grow weary and sick. And you begin to worry about your health. Now, it's so right through. Even with old Paul, you see. And I think it's important maybe to look at Paul, because a lot of us say, well, what about Paul? What about the thorn in the flesh? So could we just look briefly at 2 Corinthians 12 and 9 through 10 there? 2 Corinthians 12 and 9 through 10. Do you remember Paul is speaking in verse 8? Three times I besought the Lord about this. Now, you remember that was in verse 7. And to keep me from being too elated by the abundance of revelations, a thorn was given me in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to harass me, to keep me from being too elated. Three times I besought the Lord about this, that it should leave me. But he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. I will all the more gladly boast of my weaknesses, that the power of Christ may rest upon you, upon me. You remember we said last Sunday that from time to time, God gives some of his giants a sickness that they have to bear. But that sickness they are able to glory in because of the paradox described there in verse 9. My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Now the weakness remained. Old Paul still had an old, weak, frail body, whatever was wrong with him. And it obviously was a physical sickness if you look up some of the other references, you know, that you get to Paul's sickness. But Paul was still weak and frail. But Jesus' power was made real in the midst of that weakness. You see, that's pretty tricky. The weakness was still there, but Jesus' life surged through and achieved more than 10 men could achieve. Because Paul was constantly in shipwrecks, being stoned, being persecuted, being imprisoned, taking journeys in days when any kind of journey was misery. And so it was Jesus' life that was coming through and achieving that. Now it's very important to think that we see, you see, that you walk that by faith and not by sight. In other words, you don't look at your body and say, well, you've made it whole, so now I can go. No, you step out as the body is sick and weak. You step out and say, Lord, this weak, old, sick body will never achieve this, but I trust you to make your power real in me while my weakness is there. The two go together, loved ones. And you see, that's the way healing comes. Healing doesn't come from saying, Lord, I'll go when you heal this body. I'll go when you remove this weakness. Healing comes when you say, Lord Jesus, you've told me to go this way. The body looks weak to me, but I know I'm going to do it by your strength anyway. So I go out. And then God either removes your weakness or he provides his own strength in the midst of that weakness. And some of us have to learn that, you see. Some of us, especially who have very healthy bodies, have to learn that. Because we're so proud of our health and our strength that we want to kind of combine it with God's own strength. And God will share the glory with no one. And so often he has to bring our ordinary natural strength in our bodies to the end of itself. Do you see, our bodies are governed by our minds and emotions. But we cannot do anything for God's work with the strength of our minds and emotions. That's a natural strength. and it will always claim glory for itself. A strong body will always draw attention to itself. And so God has to bring even those of us who have strong bodies to the end of ourselves. He has to bring us into things that are beyond ourselves. I don't encourage you, you know, to go out into foolish pursuits, because God will only give you strength for what is His will. But I do point out to you that God is going to continually ask you to go beyond your own strength. And every time you hold back, you will miss the life of Jesus in you. And brothers and sisters, I've presented to you again 2.5 billion people who don't know Jesus. 800 million in China, 500 million in India, 200 million in South America. And so it goes on. Don't you see that we will have to be supermen and superwomen? Don't you see that we will have to have a supernatural strength? And what I'm saying is that's the glory of it. You go out after Jesus and He supplies this strength to you by faith, but not by sight. Of course, it ties up, you remember, with what we said about healing. If every time you have sickness, you become preoccupied with the symptoms and the phenomena, and you go to God and say, Lord, look at this weakness in my arm, look at the way my mind can't concentrate. Then as you concentrate on those phenomena and on the things that are seen, so the things that are unseen will become more and more distant, and God can do nothing with you. That's why, brothers and sisters, in a body of Christ, it is never the case that people talk about their sicknesses or their weaknesses, you see. It's not that they don't see them. They're realistic. They don't go the Christian Science route and say they're not there. They say they're there. But they don't talk about them. They talk about the life of Jesus, that they know anyway is the only thing that empowers them to do God's work. Now, it's important to get back, you know, to the old condition. And it's the same condition as we mentioned before. You have it in 2 Corinthians 4 and 10 through 11. The method or the condition under which God will give us this strength and this life. 2 Corinthians 4 and 10 through 11. It's good to see some of the things that Paul suffered to in verse 9. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Struck down, but not destroyed. Always carrying in the body the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be manifested in our bodies. So if the life of Jesus is to be manifested in our bodies, we have to be always carrying in the body the death of Jesus. And then repeat it in verse 11 again. For while we live, we are always being given up to death for Jesus' sake, so that the life of Jesus may be manifested in our mortal flesh. And you see that that's the condition. In order for the life of Jesus to be manifested in our bodies, in order for the life of Jesus to be manifested in our mortal flesh, we must be always carrying in the body the death of Jesus. We must always be given up to death for Jesus' sake. And what was the death of Jesus? Well, the dying of Jesus was all the time saying no to himself. All the time saying no to his own pleasure. All the time saying no to his own convenience. All the time saying no to his own comfort. All the same time saying no to his own future. The dying of Jesus was the death to the self-life. It was the taking of self off the throne, off the control point of the life, and putting God in charge and saying, Lord God, I live for you and for you alone. And in order to have the life of Jesus manifested in our bodies, we need to be in that position, loved ones. All the time living for Jesus, for the world, for God, never for ourselves. And all, loved ones, honestly, the world would see the healthiest group of people that it ever seen if all of us tonight, you know, really committed ourselves to that kind of life. And oh, you know, I challenge you on it. Do you want the other miserable chocolate soldier kind of life, you know? Will you look after yourself with the insurance and the right kind of house and the right kind of children and the right kind of job and the right kind of connections? Loved ones, is it to be that kind of life, you know? Or is it to be a life that is always dying to itself and always going out beyond itself? And if it is that, then God will make the life of Jesus real inside you and really continually bring you health and wholeness. And, you know, it's that kind of promise in the Bible that really says that God will supply it to us. There's another important thing, and I think we should look at it in Jeremiah 45 and 5. Jeremiah 45 and 5. A principle that I think we need to see clearly. And do you seek great things for yourself? Seek them not. For behold, I am bringing evil upon all flesh, says the Lord. But I will give you your life as a prize of war in all places to which you may go. But I will give you your life as a prize of war in all places to which you may go. And God promises that He'll give us this life as a prize of war in all places to which you may go. But He gives you it in the place. You don't stand here and say, Lord, I feel that I can't, on the advice of the medics, go to a climate such as you get in Africa, because I'm obviously not fit to face it. God said He would give you His life in all places to which you shall go. Not before you leave to go to the place, but in the place itself. That's why you can never receive life today for tomorrow. You can't gather manna for today and keep it for tomorrow. It'll spoil. In other words, the health of Jesus and the life of Jesus for your body will come moment by moment. Loved ones, it's a moment by moment receiving. So that you see, you're always leaning heavily on Jesus. You're never in a position where you say, oh yeah, I could tackle it. I have enough strength and health stored up for it. If you look forward to the thing, you'll never be able to do it. You'll never have the strength enough to say, yes, I have strength enough for next week. It's always God will give you His life as a prize of war in all places to which you shall go. And so it's in the midst of the situation itself that God will give you the strength. And all I've found is, you know, that every time I've crumbled back as a weakling and said, no, I haven't the strength for it, God has said, yes, that's right, you haven't the strength. I know you haven't the strength. And if you depend on your own strength, you'll never have the strength. But I will give you the strength at the time that you'll need it. And so it is a beautiful life, you know. It's a life that is really free from anxiety for health for tomorrow. It's a life that is free from worrying about, wonder will I have enough strength for tomorrow. It's a life that is really free when you have a bad night, you know, a sleepless night. And all the thoughts of Satan crowd in upon you and say to you, this is bound to be a miserable day because you've had no rest tonight. So let's just suffer it out. You'll be tense, you'll be taut, you'll be just worn out all day. Let's see it through as best we can and get through as soon as we can to bed. And God, you see, will give you strength for that day. So you get up in the morning and you say, yeah, I didn't get a good night's sleep, but I take the life of Jesus for my life today. Lord Jesus, I take your life for this physical body today.